I welcome you all for another interesting session of inflammatory bowel diseases. In these, we have Crohn's colitis, ulcerative colitis, and intermediate colitis. We'll start with Crohn's colitis, which is also known as regional colitis. It was first described by Crohn's in 1932, where he found a young adult getting involved with regional colitis, and then it was known as Crohn's colitis. Crohn's colitis can affect anything from the gut, from lips to anal canal, but ileocolic region is the most commonly affected regions in Crohn's disease. Epidemiology. It is most common in North America and Northern Europe. Prevalence rates are as high as 56 per 1 lakh have been reported in UK. Most commonly diagnosed in young patients between ages 25 and 40, and the second peak of incidence around the age of 55 to 60 years. It is more common in females than in males. Etiology. It is caused by chronic infection, but no causative organism has ever been found. There is similarity with tuberculosis as Mycobacterium species was seen. The other causative factor can be focal ischemia, possibly originating from a vasculitis arising through an immunological process. A wide variety of foods have now been implicated, but none conclusively have proved to cause Crohn's. Smoking increases the risk threefold. About 10% of patients have a first degree relative with the disease. There is an association with ankylosing spondylitis. Cell-mediated immunity may be defective. It can predispose to cancer, but not as high as in ulcerative colitis. Pathogenesis. There is thought to be an increased permeability of the mucous membrane. This leads to increased passage of antigen, which induces a cell-mediated inflammatory response. This in turn releases cytokines such as interleukin-2 and tumor necrosis factor, which coordinate local and systemic responses. There is a defect in suppressor T cell, which prevents escalation of inflammatory process. Ileum is the most commonly affected part, found in 60% of cases, and large intestine in 30% of cases. Lesions of mouth, esophagus, stomach, and duodenum is uncommon, but anal regions are common. Fibrotic thickening of intestinal wall with a narrow lumen is seen. Strictures showing deep mucosal ulceration with linear or snake-like pattern and dilated proximal bowel is seen. Ulcerative colitis mainly affects the colon. So you have to differentiate between ulcerative colitis and Crohn's. Ulcerative colitis usually affects the colon, whereas in Crohn's, it can affect any part of the gut, mainly the small and large intestine. In ulcerative colitis, only mucosa and submucosa are involved in the disease, whereas in Crohn's, the total complete layer of mucosa and submucosa, as well as muscular coat, all the coats of the intestine are involved in Crohn's disease. So these are the two main differences which you can remember at this point. Crohn's disease involves full thickness of bowel wall. Edema in the mucosa between the ulcer gives rise to a cobblestone appearance. Now this is important as the MCQ is asked regarding which disease will show or give you cobblestone appearance. It is Crohn's colitis or regional enteritis. The transmural inflammation resulting in adhesions, inflammatory masses with mesenteric abscess and the fistula into the adjacent organ will be seen. The serosa is usually opaque. There is thickening in the mesentery and the mesenteric lymph nodes are enlarged. This condition is discontinuous with inflamed area separated from the normal lesion, and then it is called as skip lesions. So intestine is normal between the two lesion, and then it is known as skip lesion. Microscopy A, B and C. It will show you transmural inflammation, Fissure ulcer or non-caseating granulomas located in the muscular layer of the small bowel. The earliest mucosal lesions are discrete after this ulcer. Recent studies have shown multifocal arterial occlusion in the muscularis propria. Clinical features presents, it depends on whether it is acute or chronic Crohn's disease and depends on the area of involvement. Now first we'll see acute Crohn's disease. It is seen only in 5% of cases. Clinical features are like acute appendicitis, but there is usually diarrhea preceding the attack. Again, the question usually is asked as whether diarrhea precedes the Crohn's colitis or not. So usually diarrhea precedes the attack of Crohn's colitis and then you have other symptoms. Rarely perforation of small intestine, local or diffuse peritonitis will be seen. Acute colitis with or without toxic megacolon is less common than in ulcerative colitis. In Crohn's, which is chronic disease, there will be history of mild diarrhea for months together. There will be abdominal pain in right iliac fossa. A lump might be palpable as ileocecal region is involved. Fever, anemia and weight loss will be seen. Perineal abscess, fissure, fistula are common. Children, retarded growth and sexual development will be seen. Fibrosis, stricture which will be developed in the intestine over months causing abdominal pain on eating, giving rise to what has been described as food fear. With progression of the disease, adhesion and transmural fissuring, intra-abdominal abscesses and fistula tract can develop. So there will be enteroenteric fistula, enterovesical fistula or very rarely enterocutaneous fistula. Anal disease is very common in Crohn's. The perianal skin appears bluish. Three or more edematous pinky blue fleshy tracts can be protruded from the anal margin. Superficial ulcers with undermined edges relatively painless and can heal with bridging of epithelium. There will be deep cavitating ulcers seen in the upper anal canal. They can be painful and cause perianal abscess and fistula, discharging around the anus and sometimes forwards into the genitalia. Remarkably, the rectal mucosa is often spared and may feel normal on rectal examination. Again, ulcerative colitis will cause continuous inflammation from colon and rectum. While already we have seen Crohn's disease will have skip lesions. So there will be intestine which will be absolutely normal between the two regions. And that will differentiate from ulcerative colitis and Crohn's. Skip lesions are seen in Crohn's disease. Investigation. Sigmoidoscopic investigation may be normal or show minimal involvement. Ulceration might be seen in the anal canal. In colonoscopy, it will be discontinuous nature of Crohn's disease, that means skip lesions will be seen. Normal mucosa with areas of inflamed mucosa which will be irregular, ulcerated with mucopurulent exudate. The earliest appearance are of the aphthoid-like ulcers surrounded by rim of erythematous mucosa. These become larger and deeper with increasing severity of disease. In colonic Crohn's disease strictures, it is important to exclude malignancy at these sites. Radiology, barium enema, similar features to those on colonoscopic examination will be seen in the colon. The best investigation for the small intestine is small bowel barium enema. It shows areas of delay and dilatation of partial obstruction. The involved areas tend to be narrowed, irregular, and sometimes when the length of the terminal ileum is involved, there may be a string sign of Cantor. Now this is the question which is usually asked, what is a string sign of Cantor? And if you have not heard this name, then of course that question will be unanswered. So string sign of Cantor is seen in Crohn's in barium enema at the site of ileocolic junction. The rectum is paired, and this is useful to distinguish Crohn's colitis from the ulcerative colitis. Sinogram is useful in patients with enterocutaneous fistula. CT scan useful in complex fistula and intra-abdominal abscesses. MRI is useful in assessing the perianal disease. Now we'll come to the treatment. Treatment will be medical and surgical. First will be medical therapy. Steroids are the mainstay of treatment. Patients with relapse, up to 40 mg prednisolone is given orally daily with 5 ASA. Mass of an abscess is found, then antibiotics are given. Azathioprine is used for its addictive and steroid sparing effect. Nutritional support should be given. Oral intravenous feeding or gastroenteric or nasoenteric feeding should be given. Anemia, hypoproteinemia, electrolyte, vitamin and metabolic bone problems must all be seen, addressed and treated before starting the surgical therapy. Indications for surgery. Surgery resection will not cure Crohn's disease. Surgery is therefore focused on complication of the disease and joint management by aggressive physician and a conservative surgeon is thought to be ideal. The complication and therefore the indications of surgery are recurrent intestinal obstruction, bleeding, perforation, failure of medical therapy, intestinal fistula, fulminant colitis, malignant change and perianal disease. Now we'll come to surgery. There are many surgical procedures. The main aim is to preserve functional gut length. Resection is kept to a minimum to deal with the local problem. The whole of the gastrointestinal tract has to be examined carefully at the time of laparotomy. The course of the disease after surgery is unpredictable and recurrence is common. Now we'll go to surgical procedures. First is ileocecal resection. It is usual procedure for ileocecal disease. Primary anastomosis is done between ileum and transverse colon. Second is segmental resection. Short segment of small or large bowel involvement can be treated by segmental resection and then end-to-end anastomosis. Colectomy and ileorectal anastomosis. Widespread colonic disease with rectal sparing and a normal anus is treated with colectomy and ileorectal anastomosis. Temporary loop ileostomy. In patients with acute distal Crohn's disease allowing remission and later restoration of continuity, this procedure is done. And in patients with severe perianal and rectal disease, temporary loop ileostomy is done. Proctocolectomy. Patients with colonic and anal disease failing to respond to medical treatment or defunction will eventually require proctocolectomy and permanent ileostomy. Strictureoplasty. Multiple strictured areas of Crohn's disease can be treated by local widening procedure called as strictureoplasty to avoid excessive small bowel resection. And anal disease. Usually treated conservatively by simple drainage of abscess, placing seton around any fistula. Occasionally, in patients with inactive disease, primary repair of rectovaginal or high fistula in ano could be attempted. Now we have come to end of Crohn's disease. The basic difference or the basic questions which are asked whether you have understood the difference between Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. Today, we have told and covered at least 4 to 5 differences which are majorly asked in the exam. First, as the ulcerative colitis will involve mainly colon, whereas Crohn's can involve all the gut from lips to anal canal, but ileo, small and large intestine are common. Second is ulcerative colitis will always involve only mucosa and submucosa, whereas Crohn's will involve full thickness of the intestine. Third, perianal disease is rarely seen in ulcerative colitis. Fourth, rectum is usually spared in Crohn's disease. And fifth and very important is skip lesions are usually present in Crohn's disease. In ulcerative colitis, you get confluent involvement of the rectum and colon. And I think that I have covered the confusing questions very easily. Thank you.